For this video, we're going to start with one more practice calculation determining the precipitation of ionic compounds. Here we have a double replacement reaction again, where we're combining magnesium chloride and silver nitrate. We want to know if a precipitate is going to form. So notice, really helpful hint for you, when I give the KSP value, I'm going to indicate what substance that's for. And so that's how we know that AgCl would be the precipitate here. Again, this double replacement reaction is optional. What I do need to include is my dissociation of my equilibrium system. That is the dissociation of the silver chloride salt. And again, we know we're calculating a Q value for two reasons. One, we're already given K, and two, we're asked if a precipitate is going to form. That question implies that we need to calculate Q to compare it to K. For this one, we're going to do the same thing that we did on the previous slide to figure out the concentration of ions in my original salts. I'm going to show the dissociation equation. So magnesium chloride is 0.010 molar. Therefore, magnesium would be the same. That's a 1-to-1 ratio. But notice my chloride is twice as much in here. And so my initial chloride concentration is going to be the 0.020 molar. For silver nitrate, that also is a soluble salt. So that's going to completely dissociate into the silver and nitrate ions in a 1-to-1 ratio. So you don't have to show this work. If you recognize that it's going to be a 1-to-1 and be exactly the same for both, you don't need to show this. But I do like showing this one specifically for the chloride ion up there. And we have our silver ion. So plugging into our Q expression, silver is going to be a 0.056 molar, chloride is 0.020 molar. And when we plug those values in, our Q is 0.00112. Again, sig figs don't technically matter because we weren't asked to solve for Q, but we do want to compare our Q to K. And pretty obvious once we write those exponents that our Q is greater than K. So remember, Q bigger than K means that Q needs to decrease. The only way for Q to decrease is for the equilibrium system to shift back left. And remember, the equilibrium system we're describing here is the dissociation of silver chloride. So when that shifts back left, that's where our solid is. This is the one scenario that will result in precipitation. So this salt will precipitate. We do have some extra example practice problems from the textbook to work, and in your slides, you have the solution here. The very last few slides that I want to discuss are some factors that affect solubility, one of the key ones being pH. So notice here we're describing the insoluble salt magnesium hydroxide. The fact that it's insoluble, notice its K value, 10 to the minus 11, this is why magnesium hydroxide is a weak base. It is not completely soluble because of that KSP value. And so if we were to solve for X using our same setups that we've used before, we determine that our hydroxide concentration in this salt, hydroxide is 2 times that concentration, we could actually solve for the pH of this solution this way. But it also turns out that I can determine what will help magnesium hydroxide dissolve and what will help it precipitate more. And because this is a basic salt, it's going to be pH dependent. So realize that if I have a pH of less than 10.45, the solubility of my magnesium hydroxide is going to increase. And the way that I would do that would be to add acid, right, to lower my pH. So realize that if I add acid, that acid is actually going to react with the hydroxide in here, removing it from solution, and that's going to force my equilibrium to shift to the right. therefore increasing the solubility. By the same token, hopefully it makes sense that if we were to add a base to this magnesium hydroxide solution, we would effectively be increasing our hydroxide concentration, shifting our equilibrium to the left, and we would decrease the solubility or precipitate more. And so depending on whether an insoluble salt is acidic, basic, or neutral, we'll determine how we can get it to dissolve or precipitate. At GCC, we perform a qualitative analysis lab. In this one, our goal with qualitative is that we're not worried about numbers. We're just trying to separate out ions. And so if you take the lab with us, we actually use this flow chart as a means to help you figure out a procedure to separate these four anions, chloride, iodide, carbonate, and sulfate. So this flowchart helps you work through adding reagents in the right order so that you can then isolate and confirm the presence of each ion in here. And this lab works because of a process called selective precipitation. So in that lab, we work with both silver chloride and silver iodide and realize that they do have different KSP values, meaning that it takes different substances, different concentrations of solutions to dissolve or precipitate these. So for example, silver chloride, if I have a mixture of silver chloride and silver iodide, I would have to separate these by adding something that will dissolve them. And we determine that by figuring out what type of salt this is going to be. Is it acidic, basic, or neutral? And hopefully you remember from chapter 14, that this would actually be an acidic salt. It's made from a strong acid, right? We have the conjugate base of a strong acid, and we have a cation that comes from a weak base. So this is acidic. And so it means that if I were to add a base to this, I can add ammonia and get my silver chloride to dissolve. Since silver chloride has a smaller KSP, it's going to dissolve before the silver iodide. Just so you know, in lab, it turns out that AgCl will dissolve with 6 molar ammonia. AgI, however, when we add 15 molar ammonia, I want you to think about that number for a second, by the way, 15 molar. Very, very careful when you're working with it. 15 molar ammonia, this one actually doesn't dissolve. So it is so insoluble, that 10 to the minus 17, that no base will dissolve that silver iodide. Another topic we briefly talk about, we've mentioned this and referenced this a couple of times this semester, the new type of formula called a complex ion. We saw this in Le Chatelier's principle. We had a couple of examples of complex ions there. And we see it here in the qualitative analysis lab. So in that previous slide, I mentioned that we could get silver chloride to dissolve with 6 molar ammonia. And when we do that, we actually form a complex of silver with 2 ammonia molecules attached. That's still an ion, and then we have the chloride ion. And so we dissolve it by getting the silver and the chloride separated from each other, even though silver is now bonded to another substance. It's still considered aqueous. And so to confirm the presence of a salt, since adding a base dissolved our acidic salt, when I add an acid to my products here, that should form reprecipitation. So down here, taking our products from above, adding the acid of nitric acid reforms our precipitate to verify its presence, and then we're left with some ammonium nitrate. And it turns out that most complex ions tend to be very stable. They will be very product favored. So forming them, notice we have very large equilibrium constants here, meaning that when we're working with these, they are stable compounds. They do want to form. They're very product favored. The very last slide that we have in this chapter is the definition of another set of acids and bases, and this is Lewis acids and bases. So hopefully this sounds familiar. We're actually working with or building off of Lewis dot structures, the electron dot structures. In here, a Lewis base is any substance that can donate a pair of electrons. So this is actually the most accurate description of why ammonia is a base. It has that lone pair of electrons on nitrogen. And so thinking back to the complex we just talked about of silver with two ammonia molecules, this is actually an acid-base reaction. So our ammonia is the base, the silver ion is the acid, and we form this complex ion with silver in the middle. So the Lewis base is the one that can donate a pair of electrons. A Lewis acid is one that can accept that pair of electrons. For those of you continuing on to organic chemistry, they will predominantly use these definitions because they are working with the transfer of electrons, the movement of electrons as chemical reactions happen.